In the next three videos, we are going to discuss some basic implementations of the inverter technology. In particular, in this video, the H-bridge type will be presented. More in depth, we will go through the topology of the H-bridge inverter, the components that form this power electronic device, the modes of operation that are usually employed to pass from DC to AC power, and finally, we are going to have a quick look at the three-phase topology of the H-bridge inverter. The H-bridge presents four switches, named from S1 to S4. The name of this type of converter is given by the typical shape which resembles the letter H. The load here is situated in the middle between the four switches. Typically, the basic components of this converter are the switches that can be IGBTs, MOSFETs or T-resorts. Then we have flyback diodes in anti-parallel configuration to the switches, inductor and capacitor that act as a filter at the inverter output. The anti-parallel diodes are included in the design in order to avoid that damage due to reverse over currents occurs on the switching devices. A basic example of operation of the H-bridge is rather similar to the one seen in the DC-DC converter topologies. There are two possible switch configurations. Either S1 and S4 are closed and S2 and S3 are open, or S1 and S4 are open, and S2 and S3 are closed. When S1 and S4 switches are closed, or switched on, the current ID will start flowing through them and passing into the load. Let's now visualize how the load voltage Vout changes with time. When S1 and S4 are closed, the voltage has a positive polarity and equals the input voltage. When there is a commutation between the two switch pairs, S1 and S4 are switched off, while S2 and S3 are switched on, almost instantly. The current will start to flow through S2 and S3 and again into the load. In this case, the voltage will be again equal to the input voltage, but of inverse polarity. This cycle goes on giving the typical square wave output voltage. A DC to AC converter is capable of switching between two states, logically speaking between 0 and 1. This means that, as we have seen in the previous slide, the real output will be always a pulsed wave. In order to define the real power transferred by the inverter, we have to refer to a pure sine wave. To do so, Fourier analysis must be adopted. Through Fourier's analysis, it is possible to describe a periodic signal as the sum of an arbitrary number of sine and cosine functions. If the output signal is an odd function, the first harmonic of or fundamental is a pure sine. It is the only harmonic that carries active power. On the other hand, the harmonics of a higher order generate distortion in the signal and therefore need to be filtered out by a low-pass filter. Here we can see the third harmonic in red and the fifth harmonic in blue. Summing these three harmonics, we obtain an approximation of the original square wave. Adding up more harmonics makes, of course, the approximation more accurate. A three-phase inverter shows a switching section consisting of six switches coupled again with the feedback diodes placed anti-parallel to the devices. Three lines are drawn for the three phases of the output voltage, after which are usually placed inductive coils in series and a capacitor bank in parallel that can work as a low-pass filter. As seen before, this filter is fundamental to reduce the harmonic distortion to the output waveform. Unlike the DC-DC topologies with only one switch, the presence of multiple switches allows to have more combinations and the different output shapes given by the different duty ratios. One of the most used switching strategies is the pulse width modulation, or PWM, that we are going to deal with more extensively in the next video. If the power converted from DC to AC is less than 100 kilowatts, the switching devices used are usually self-commutated ones. Among these devices, we can mention the IGBT, the MOSFET, and the GTO, among others. These devices are characterized by very fast switching and feature a controller that takes care of the opening and closing of the transistors. When it comes to power higher than 100 kilowatts, line commutated semiconductor devices such as thyristors are chosen. Unlike self-commutated devices, thyristors need an input signal, usually retrieved from the grid, to start conducting. This option is typically employed for high-voltage DC and high-voltage AC applications. To sum up, we saw that a H-bridge DC to AC converter is composed by switches, flyback diodes, inductors and capacitors. We also saw that the output waveform of the inverter is a pulse train that can be seen as a pure sine wave superposed to other higher order sine waves that create harmonic distortion. The square wave is then the sum of all the harmonics. Finally, we saw the typical topology of a triphase inverter. Thank you for watching and see you in the next video.